Wesley Zacharias from Wagner, South Dakota. And I just had my birthday last Monday. So I'm 83 years old now.
Well, congratulations and happy birthday then, Mr. Zacharias. And could you tell me how old you were when you went into the service and what branch of the service you were in and what your rank was?
I was in the Army, took basic training in Camp Hood, Texas. And I was wound up in Sioux City, Iowa when President Roosevelt died.
Were you drafted or did you volunteered? Okay. And so do you remember how old you were when they drafted you?
I was 21.
21, okay. And do you remember when Pearl Harbor happened, where you were and what you were doing?
Yes. I guess I was in basic training when Pearl Harbor was before.
Well, you were drafted then after the attack on Pearl Harbor. Is that right? Okay. And so you were drafted and you went into the Army.
Right.
Where were you shipped out? When did you end up going to Europe?
No, I went to Japan.
Oh, you were in the Pacific Theater.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I shouldn't have made that presumption.
When I got down with basic, they sent you home for 15-day leave, I guess. And then I rode the trains to California. And in the meantime, I was going to Japan, I guess. And the atomic bomb fell just then. So I was happy about that.
So you were in, were you in the South Pacific prior to the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki?
No. It dropped before I got there, just before.
Oh, I see. So you ended up not having to go.
No, I wound up, And when I got to Japan, I wound up by Hiroshima, which was not very far from, Fujiyama in the 27th Division. And that wasn't very far from Hiroshima.
Mm-hmm. So what was your role in the military? What was the job that you had to do once you got shipped out of the States?
Well, in Japan, we did scouting around. We took over an army camp, Japanese old army camp, and we scouted out for soldiers around and this and that. Oh, I know one day we went down by Fujiyama and we found a kind of a small building out there in a grove of trees. We went in there and knocked on the door, opened the door up, and there was two Japanese in there. Didn't know the war was over.
they didn't realize that
no.
Everything had ended.
No. And they was putting together pistols. Just the two of them. I don't know how many thousands of pistols they had there and the parts they was putting them together.
And so then did you take them prisoner?
Yeah, we took them prisoners.
Okay. So you were part of the occupying forces after the war more or less had ended.
Yeah.
So how long did you stay in Japan?
Well, just about a year. I didn't get home till October 12th, I think, when we landed in San Francisco.
Okay. Are there specific things about that experience that you will always remember or that you have always remembered?
Yeah.
Besides the two guys with the pistols.
Well, we got married before I went in the Army, and we had a son, Jim, and he was 10 months old before I got to see him. So that was kind of a rough deal.
Sure, sure. Were you able to write back and forth with
your
wife?
I wrote a letter just about every other day, I think. But mail was so slow. Sometimes you wouldn't get a letter for a week.
Mm-hmm. And were your letters censored? Did the military?
I don't know if they were or not. You couldn't quite tell.
So did you have brothers who also were in the military or
no? I only had one sister.
Okay. Okay, so but your folks were back home then,
yeah,
as well.
Right.
Okay.
They farmed south of Wagner.
Okay. What was the experience like? Are there things like the smells? You know, every place seems to have its own distinctive sounds and smells and things. Where you were in Japan, what was that like?
It smelled like fish, dead fish.
Most of the time?
Oh, yeah.
And
well, we out in, when I first got there, well, then they sent the 27th Division home. The 27th Division was on its way home from Europe. And out in the ocean someplace, they got a hold of them and they sent them to Japan. And there wasn't very much left of it. And all them guys was in the 27th Division in Europe for 5 years. And boy, they wasn't very happy.
I can imagine they wouldn't have been.
So then it took about 2 months, I think, or 3 months we was there. Then they sent them home. And I got moved to, by Yokohama into an NI aircraft. And we guarded all the docks in Japan, in Yokohama.
Okay. So you were by the water, you were on the
station. Yeah, it was old barracks, concrete barracks. About 8 miles out of Japan where we was headquartered. And we went to Yokohama to guide the ship's docks. And there was all kinds of ships unloading all kinds of stuff.
So that was part of your job, was unloading those things on the ships?
Well, all we had to do is, they had the Japanese do the work, but all we had to do is guard it so they wouldn't, they'd steal everything, you know, left and right, break into it, eat it, and whatever they could do.
Mm-hmm. Now, you said it smelled like fish a lot. Did you eat a lot of fish
No.
while you were there?
I still don't like fish.
Oh, is that right? But you didn't like fish before you got there?
No.
Okay. What are some of the things that you remember about being there that might be something people wouldn't have expected or might not have thought you would deal with while you were in Japan?
You mean the Japanese people?
Oh, the Japanese people, or you know, that people back home might have been surprised about.
Well, I don't know. I guess I was more thinking about getting home for anything.
You weren't interested in hanging around and having a good time. You just wanted to get out, do your job, and get out of there.
Right. That wasn't a very nice place to be. People, there wasn't nothing left there hardly. It was all burned up from incendiary bombs. And
so there wasn't, the landscape was not,
no,
not
was,
a pretty landscape.
No, there was not much left. Yokohama, the city itself, why, there was just a few little buildings left. And everything was burned up. They all used the incendiary bombs.
Did you wish that you had been sent somewhere else, maybe?
Yeah, it would have been a lot better. My brother-in-law, he went to serve the same time I did. And he got to go to Europe, and he was sending letters and what kind of a good time he had over there and all this and that. I was in that stinking hole.
So it smelled bad besides the fish, huh?
Oh, the whole country stayed.
So you have not, have you ever thought about going back to see what it's
like
today?
No.
No desire to do that?
No, no.
Well, after the war ended then, or well, the war had ended, after you got to come home, then what was the most interesting thing about life, or the thing you liked best about life back in the United States when you did come back?
Well, everything was beautiful. Felt like you was decently back to normal life again.
And you came back to South Dakota right away?
Oh, yeah. I wound up in Fort Lewis, Washington, and I don't know, probably 2 weeks before they send us home. And come home on the train again, and then I was supposed to go back and get my discharge, and I said, no, I ain't going back. And I said, they might change their mind, so they send it to me.
You were afraid if you went back, they might say this, that they needed you again, huh?
Right, they wanted me to come back, fix my teeth, and then give me my discharge, and I said, no, thank you.
You thought they had dentists here in South Dakota, huh?
Right.
You know, I don't think I blame you. So then, did you go into farming, or what was your life like after
right.
you came back?
My wife, she helped my dad farm when I was gone. So we took over the farm then, and been farming until we retired here a few years ago.
What about U.S. involvement in that particular war? I mean, did you think that we did need to be involved in that war?
Oh, I'm sure. We if it wouldn't have been for an atomic bomb, we'd, I don't know, I wouldn't be here today. They was so underground. Everything was underground. Their guns and everything along shorelines. And that, I don't know, it'd have been tough to get them out.
You think that the war would have continued for a lot longer?
Long time. Even if we had, you know, there was shiploads and shiploads and shiploads of us unloading in Japan then. When I got there, and after I got there, and I don't know, I think we'd have been all, half of us would have died, I know.
What part of what happened during those years do you think is important for people today to know about that they might not know about? You know, younger people who don't know a thing about World War II, what do you think it would be important for them to know?
You mean about why we was fighting them?
Either that or things about the war that maybe, you know, sometimes we don't hear the stories of gentlemen and like yourself, so.
After Pearl Harbor, that was a mess. That was terrible. So something had to be done. And I don't know, I guess them islands that the other guys was fighting in was the same thing. It was terrible. Underground and everything else. And I don't know, the Japanese, they just didn't care what they did. Commit suicide and everything else, you know, just so they could win the war, but it didn't happen that way.
Did you think about the Japanese one way or another before the war?
Well, in basic, I was hoping I didn't have to go there, yes.
How much information was available to people about what was going on in the war during those years? Did the newspapers cover it very much or not?
Well, yeah, but it wasn't like today, you know, that this very, no pictures and stuff like that. The thing is, what you got to read, which wasn't that much either. I guess Ernie Pyle was the only one that ever wrote anything from the war.
He was actually in the field with the
soldiers.
Yeah,
he was in the front lines everywhere.
Okay, and so you feel like that was the most honest report.
Right, right.
Going on.
And then we had the I guess it was put out by the Army or what, the Stars and Stripes.
Mm-hmm.
And that he was all kinds of stories in there. He had, that was the only newspaper that ever printed much, I think. Well, especially overseas, that's all we heard. There was no radios or nothing, you know, so.
And while you were in Japan, did you know much about what was going on back home?
No.
Besides the letters from your
never,
wife?
You know, nothing. We never had, you didn't have no news of any kind. No paper, no, nothing. No radio. If there was a radio, it had some Japanese squabbling on there.
Okay. So did
I guess they had Tokyo Rose on there. I never even had a radio. Nobody did.
Oh, is that right? So in your unit, you didn't get to listen to Tokyo Rose.
No.
So did you feel that the rest of the people back home, supported what you were doing when you were there? Because, you know, I think there were some people who felt like, okay, so we go in and we beat them, but maybe they felt differently about the occupying force.
I don't know. I don't think so. I just, somebody had to help clean it up, you know, and straighten them out. But they wasn't too hard to convince. Once that bomb fell, they were so glad the war was over with that they, it was really nice to us. Other than trying to eat, they was hungry. Oh, they was hungry. Kids would pile up around you and holler for stuff to eat.
Was that part of the Army's job, was to help make sure that there was enough food or not?
I don't think so. I don't know. I never.
It wasn't what you were there to do?
No, no.
Okay.
What I was there for really was make sure that they didn't get back to fighting again, you know, because they had these soldiers come in from the islands and all that. I don't even know where they went to, but they hauled them in someplace. I suppose certain camps and whatnot before they sent them home. And they didn't send them home very fast, a few at a time.
Are there things that I haven't asked you about that stand out in your memory about the war? I've always been curious about C rations and K rations myself.
Yeah, them was really tasty.
No. I have a feeling that's not very sincere.
No, that wasn't. But a little later on, then we had halfway decent meals. But that K ration, I don't know.
It kept you alive?
No, yeah.
But you can't say much else about it, huh?
No.
Not much to recommend.
It wasn't very tasty.
So did you miss the food from home quite a bit while you were
there? Oh, yeah. That was, everybody thought about different kinds of food at home.
So and what was the first thing you wanted to eat when you got back?
Ice cream. I ate ice cream like you wouldn't believe.
Yeah?
Oh, God.
Any particular flavor?
No, it didn't make no difference as long as it was ice cream.
So you didn't have any at all while you were gone?
No.
And how many years was that?
Well, year and a half
year
at least.
Year and a half without any ice cream? Wow.
Yeah, I sure missed that. And I don't know, the first Thanksgiving I spent over there where they said we're going to have fried chicken. I don't know what kind of a chicken it was, but the legs on the chicken was as big as my arm just about. But it did taste decent.
So do you think they were feeding you turkey?
Yeah, that's what it looked like. But it wasn't. It was chicken.
I was going to say
some
fried
old
turkey.
Roosters.
Fried turkey doesn't sound very good.
No.
So there were some memorable meals. They tried to make it more pleasant
yeah.
for you.
Yeah. Right.
Yep. Were you ever injured or wounded during the course of your service?
Into the what?
Were you ever hurt?
No. Didn't wind up in the hospital there. I was lucky there.
And so you farmed then for how many years, you said, after you came back? You just retired a few years ago.
Retired, what, 8 years ago, I think. Yeah, and moved to town.
Mm-hmm. Once you got home, did you feel like the war was just something that was part of the past? Did you think about it much in the years?
Yeah, you just kind of more or less put it away and forgot about it, mm-hmm. or tried to. Yeah. Pretty much.
What about the things that have happened as far as conflict and war in the years since then? Korea and Vietnam?
We had the son that I didn't see till he was 8 months old, while he wound up in Vietnam,
mm-hmm.
for a year or more. And that was another bad place.
Because you had been in Japan and had seen those things, did that make it hard for you to think of him being in Vietnam?
Yeah, it did. But he had a movie camera, and so he would send us tapes, which helped somewhat. And then we sent tapes over there to him. We had got a movie camera, and that helped a lot.
Is there anything I haven't asked you about yet that you think it's important to talk about?
The hunger, how bad it was in Japan, was unbelievable. But we never had no civil war or anything. We ate out of our mess kits all the time I was there. And if you had any food left over, well, you put outside into a trash can. And they Japanese people, the old people, kids would be lined up for a block, and they'd fight like dogs, you know, to get that little bit of food every day. So hunger is the worst thing I ever saw.
Did you see a lot of people who were sick? Within, you said you weren't very far away, you said, from Hiroshima, is that right?
Yeah.
Did you see people who were sick with problems related to the bomb being dropped at all?
No, I never seen no sick people.
Okay.
Lots of old people too. There was no young men. I think they was all in the service.
So women and children and old people, but no young men.
Yeah, otherwise you didn't see no young men. Young men and old people, old women, they have those great big racks of wood on their backs they carry home.
So was it kind of more like being in the country where you were? It was like rural?
Well, being roads, that was all lined with houses. That was kind of like, shops and you name it. And out in the country where there was very many people, seemed like they all lived along the main road.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd go out to farm their little rice paddies.
Did you eat a lot of rice while you were there?
No. They'd mix them boiled fish eyes and that with that rice and that seaweed out of the ocean. And that didn't look very appetizing. They mixed that all together in one little tin box, and that was their food for the day.